स्टार्ट।
हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। दिस इज डॉक्टर नवजोत त्रिवेदी, डीन पारुल इंस्टीट्यूट ऑफ फिजियोथेरेपी, पारुल यूनिवर्सिटी, वडोदरा। वी ऑल आर हियर वेलकमिंग यू फॉर दिस वेबिनार ऑर्गेनाइज्ड बाय फैकल्टी ऑफ फिजियोथेरेपी, पारुल यूनिवर्सिटी। द वेबिनार इज ऑन कार्डियोपल्मोनरी फिजियोथेरेपी टेक्निक, एविडेंस एंड रीजनिंग फॉर क्लिनिकल इम्प्लीमेंटेशन बाय Dr. Tarpan H. Shah, Vice Principal and Associate Professor, Sri Swaminarayan Physiotherapy College, Surat. He's a very knowledgeable person. He has done his master's in cardiorespiratory and currently working as an associate professor and vice principal. Today he's going to deliver us much more detailed knowledge on cardiopulmonary physiotherapy techniques and the reasoning in clinical implementation, which is much required for a clinical physiotherapist to know, as we all are giving a treatment to the patient, but that reasoning will give us or make us the best cardiorespiratory physiotherapist. So I'll hand over Dr. Tarpan Shah to continue with this topic. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
Please, sir, continue.
Okay. So first and foremost, I would like to welcome you all for this live webinar on a topic, cardiopulmonary physiotherapy techniques and evidences, techniques, evidences and reasoning for clinical implementation, organized by the Parul University Vadodara. I would like to extend my thanks from the bottom of my heart to Dr. Navjot sir and Dr. Gaurav sir for their invitation to me as a speaker for this live webinar. I would like to thank all of you, each one of you who is watching me right now. I would like to thank each one of you from the left ventricle and SA node of my heart for giving valuable 2 hours from your life to me. I will see to that it will be worthful to all of you. Now, my prerequisites for this presentation is, please attend from the beginning till the end. If you are a novices, that means if you are new in the field of the cardiopulmonary physiotherapy, if you are in the encapsulation phase, that means you are having a moderate experience, or if you are an expert in this field, whichever the category you belong, okay, I have something for you in this particular presentation for today. So we will start with this presentation. So first, I want all of you to raise your hand like this. Okay, all of you, please raise the hand like this. Yeah, take your hands up, raise your hand like this. Close your eyes. Please close your eyes. All of you, please close your eyes and listen to my command. Hands up, eyes close. Hands up, eye close. Listen to my command. Feel proud on yourself. Feel proud on yourself. These are the hands which makes the difference in the treatment of the patient. Feel proud on yourself. These are the hands which makes the difference in the treatment of the patient. Feel proud on yourself. These are the hands which makes the difference in the treatment of the patient. Slowly open your eyes and take both the hands down. Okay, thank you very much. Now let's start with our today's learning. Okay, so the outline, what we are going to learn today is about the different domains of the cardiopulmonary physiotherapy. What are the manual techniques available along with it, its evidences and the clinical reasoning, advanced techniques with its evidences and reasoning, and different instruments or the equipments which we use along with the evidences and reasoning, and what are the other approaches that we are using for the treatment of the patient. Okay, now with this beautiful infographics, I would like to bring it to your notice that how we are different from the other branches of the physiotherapy. The major difference here is we are dealing or we are treating the patient when they are in the critical stage most of the time. So our treatment starts with the critical care till the complete rehabilitation. So here we have to make ourselves capable enough to treat the patient when they are in a critical stage. So this is how we are different than the other branches. Now, what are the different domains of the cardiopulmonary physiotherapy? If you're already a cardiopulmonary physiotherapist, then also you can work very specifically or special regards to the different domain. You can work exclusively in the ICU physiotherapy, you can work exclusively for treatment of the cardiac patient. That means you can work into the area of the cardiac rehab. You can work exclusively in the area of the pulmonary rehabilitation. And this fourth domain is gaining the attention, that is general health promotion and the fitness. Now, this domain is gaining a good attention. You can work exclusively into this domain as well. Now, apart from this, we have other domains as well. So let me give you one example of a vascular disease, peripheral vascular disease. So we have mainly three types of vascular conditions: arterial disease, venous disease, and lymphatic disease. I repeat, arterial disease, venous disease, and lymphatic disease. Now, arterial disease, we need to remember which are the conditions we treat. So you must have tasted a chocolate called New Nestle Bar 1, B-A-R-O-N-E 1. Now, what I have done, I'm going to give you one mnemonics. Now, B-A-R, you add B, triple A-R, and then 1. So bar 1 is the mnemonics for the arterial disease. Remember this. So with this, you will be able to remember it for a long time. B stands for Burgess disease. A stands for arteriosclerosis. A stands for atherosclerosis. A stands for aneurysm. And R stands for Raynaud's disease. So I repeat, Burgess disease, arteriosclerosis, atherosclerosis, aneurysm, and Raynaud's disease. So these are the main five arterial disease. Second is your disease of the vein. So you know the mnemonics I have made for the disease of the vein is PVD. Yes, PVD. And just add one more P. So it is PPVD. PPVD. So P stands for phlebitis or thrombophlebitis. Another P stands for pulmonary embolism. Another V stands for varicose vein. And D stands for deep vein thrombosis. So I repeat once again, phlebitis or thrombophlebitis, pulmonary embolism, varicose vein, and deep vein thrombosis. Now, the next is your lymphatic disease. So that is your lymphedema. So to highlight this, we have four main domains: ICU physiotherapy, cardiac rehab, pulmonary rehab, general health promotion and fitness. And I have given one more domain, that is about treating the peripheral vascular disease patients. Now, what we are going to do now is we are going to learn about all these domains in detail and which are the techniques which we use, what are the best available evidence for the same, and what is the reasoning for using the techniques. But before that, I'm going to give you one golden statement which you have to remember. Okay, I feel there are mainly three types of problems in the body. Okay, first is your biochemical problem, second is your anatomical or structural problem, and third one is your mechanical problem. I repeat once again, anatomical or structural problem, biochemical problem, and mechanical problem. So most of the biochemical problems, like your imbalance in the chemicals, okay, blood glucose level, and many more. So this type of issues can be very well treated with the help of the medicines. Biochemical issues can be very well treated with the help of the medicine. Anatomical or structural problems, like say grade 3 ligament tear, okay, or say complicated communicated fracture. So in that case, surgical option is your treatment of choice. That means what? Anatomical problem, you go with the surgery. But when it comes to the mechanical problem, there comes the role of the physiotherapist. So mechanical problems are like, say, decreased in the range of movement, increase in the muscle strength. So this type of issues when it arises, okay, so there exclusively we have a role to play as a cardiopulmonary physiotherapist or as a physiotherapist. I hope you have understood. Now let us try to understand the first domain. Now ICU physiotherapy, the main aim of the cardiopulmonary physiotherapist in the intensive care unit. Okay, so before I will explain you what we do in the intensive care unit, it is imperative for all of us to have an idea about what is ICU. Intensive care unit, it is a set aside area in any hospital for the treatment of the patient who is critically ill. Now, there are so many different types of intensive care unit. Just to give you an example, NICU, neonatal intensive care unit, PICU, pediatric intensive care unit, MICU, medical intensive care unit, SICU, surgical intensive care unit, ITU, intensive therapy unit. So like this n number of different types of the ICU we have, especially with reference to the cardiac. Okay, some hospitals, they write it down CICU, cardiac intensive care unit, and some hospitals, they write CICU as a coronary intensive care unit. Okay, so now you are aware what is ICU, what are the types of the ICU. Very important to have an idea about the different levels of ICU. We have three different levels of ICU: level 1, level 2, and level 3. Level 1 is a small ICU, around 6 to 8 bed. You will see mostly this type of ICU in the town or slightly urban area, where the facility in terms of the biochemistry lab, in terms of the medical professionals, and in terms of admitting the patient for a longer period of time is quite less. So if you need to admit the patient for a longer duration, you want more investigations, more facilities, then patient has to be shifted to the level 2 ICU. And now the level 3 ICU. Level 3 ICU is the advanced intensive care unit setup. So mostly you will see the level 3 ICU in the tertiary care hospitals. So where medical professionals who is specialized in working in the ICU is available 24/7 into 365. Almost all the investigations are available that can be done in the intensive care unit itself, and based off the treatment can be provided into the level 3 ICU. Okay, so afterwards it is important for you to know, okay, about the protocols for patient care in the ICU. So intensive care unit, the head of the intensive care unit will be mostly intensivist. Some ICU may be anesthetist, and some ICU may be chest physician. Now, the protocols of the patient care, it includes daily rounds. All the people or the professionals who is treating the patient, they should see the cases as a team every day in the intensive care unit. The other protocol, it includes never, never make any assumption for the treatment of the patient. If you have a bit of doubt also, make it clear. Have the open communication. This is the golden statement. Have the open communication with all the professionals when you are working in the intensive care unit. No assumption, okay? Open communication, and then you treat the patient. The other protocols of patient care, it includes proper utilization of the intravenous line, prevention of the stress-induced gastritis, proper blood glucose control, and so on. Now, after knowing about the protocols of the patient care, we should know what we have to do as a physiotherapist in the intensive care unit. So as a physiotherapist, most of the time, okay, if the patient is intubated, that means the patient is kept on the ventilator, or if the patient is unconscious, okay, or if the patient is not, vitals are not stable, in conditions like this, you cannot take in detail history from the patient. So like demographic data, history taking, examination, and so on. So you cannot take everything from the patient. So most of the time, you need to rely on the clipboard, which is kept at the bedside, in which all the information is written. Then a file of the patient, you can communicate with the nursing staff and the other professionals. You can rely exclusively on your examination assessment findings. And based on that, you need to provide the treatment. Now let us come to the exact the role of the physiotherapist in the intensive care unit. Okay, so first role is for the prevention of secondary complications. So mainly three complications you have to remember. The first complication is prevention of accumulation of secretions in the chest. Second complications, prevention of deep vein thrombosis. And the third complication is to prevent the bed sores. Apart from this also, we have other complications like breakdown of the skin, then to decrease the strength, muscle strength and the bone strength, and many other. So now my focus will be on how to prevent the accumulation of secretions in the chest. You all of you are aware, when any patient undergoing any major surgery, the patient will be given anesthesia, and this general anesthesia will have the effects on the respiratory tract as well. Now, one of the effects of the general anesthesia is it reduces the ciliary movement, okay? So what will happen? The cilia cannot function properly. Cilia is a structure which is like a crop in a farm. It moves from the one direction to the another direction. It is having a gel layer and sole layer. It acts like a mucociliary escalator, and it will be very helpful to bring the mucus to the main airway. So now what happens, the cilia will be paralyzed after the patient is taking the anesthesia for some time. So what will happen after any major surgery, there will be accumulation of secretions in the chest. Very important for you to first mobilize it, and second, you have to remove it with the help of different chest physiotherapy techniques. Now, if you are not doing this, then what will happen? Let me tell you. The secretions will be accumulated in the chest. It can give rise to the infections, that means the pneumonia, and later on it can go for the atelectasis or the collapse. So what you need to do is to remove the secretion at the earliest. The second point, okay, the second complication which you want to prevent, that is deep vein thrombosis. So we have a role in the prevention of that, and most commonly you have seen that most of the ICU, okay, the therapists are recommending ankle toe movement, and most of the patient who undergo major surgery, they'll be given with the anti-embolytic stockings. Majority of the patients, they will be given with the anti-embolytic stockings. The third complication is your pressure sore, also known as the bed sore or also known as the decubitus ulcer. So now here we have role in the prevention of it, and we have a role in the management of it. Now the first question, how to prevent the pressure sore? So you can prevent the pressure sore by frequently turning the position of the patient, frequently turning the patient or changing the position. That is the first thing. Second, you can prescribe the water bed, you can provide the air bed, you can use sheepskins, sorbo rubbers, and so many options available for the prevention. And once the pressure sore develops, mostly develops on the weight bearing area, especially say sacrum, okay, say on the heel, okay, and so on. So in that case, you can think about using say laser, UVR, okay, diffraction massage, and so on. Okay, but mainly I felt we have to work on the prevention of the bed sore. Now, if we think about the ICU physiotherapy as a globe, okay, in the global scenario, okay, last few years, okay, which has catched the attention of most of the therapists, and now we are using it very widely, almost in all the intensive care unit, is how to do the early mobilization in the intensive care unit. It's a non-pharmacological approach, very, very helpful to the patient, so it is gaining a wide popularity. So I will be discussing about this on the later on part of my presentation. Now the third very important point for us when we are working in the ICU, that is to wean off the patient from the mechanical ventilation. So when you are doing the chest clearance, you are removing the secretions from the chest, that also, that itself will be helpful to patient if you want to wean off. That is the first thing. Second, you can go with the different positioning, you can go with the different facilitatory techniques, you can think of applying the chest PNF and so on. So this will be helpful, okay, when intensivist wants to wean off the patient from the mechanical ventilation. So we have a very good role to play in weaning the patient from the mechanical ventilation. Okay, fine. Now you have understood some about the ICU physiotherapy. Now let me give you an idea about the cardiac rehabilitation or the cardiac related disease and disorders. What are the evidences we have, and what are the techniques and approaches we give it to this group of the patient? The first thing you have to remember, we have four phases in the cardiac rehabilitation. Yes, we have four phases in the cardiac rehab. And most of the hospitals, okay, they give only up to the phase three of the cardiac rehabilitation. Now you might be asking one question to me, okay, that only three phases are given, and actually the four phases has to be given. So whether giving a three phases of cardiac rehabilitation, it will be beneficial, then my answer will be yes. Even if you give a shorter cardiac rehabilitation program, it has a very significant improvement in the patient on a long term. This is what our research evidence says, and I will show you for the same. Okay, so whether you give three phase or whether you give four phase, it will be going to be very helpful to your patient. Now, cardiac rehabilitation, it's nothing that you need to give only to the surgically managed cases like your valve repair and replacement, okay, coronary artery bypass grafting, left ventricular assistance device, and so on. It can be given to the conservatively managed cases with the cardiac conditions like your myocardial infarction, MI. So myocardial infarction, it's a type of IHD, ischemic heart disease, and prosternal chest pain. That means the pain behind the sternum. That's the first clinical presentation. Second, you will see the abnormality in the ECG. And the third one, you can see increased in the cardiac enzymes. That is your CPK, creatinine, phosphokinase, troponin T, etc. So now, retrosternal chest pain, abnormal ECG, and cardiac enzymes elevated. Out of these three, if any two is also present, you can diagnose a patient is having a myocardial infarction. And why I am concerned about it? Because conservatively managed case of a myocardial infarction, they will be referred to you to give a cardiac rehabilitation program. So the difference between the conservatively managed case for the cardiac rehab and the surgically managed case is, in the conservatively managed cases, we give physiotherapy slowly. The progression for the exercise will be slow compared to the surgically managed cases. You have to remember this. This is very important clinically. Now, here I had mentioned about the three different goals and three different areas where we work as a cardiopulmonary physiotherapist. First is exercise counseling and training. Golden statement here. Remember once again, okay, for any exercise, let it be ortho, neuro, cardio, pediatrics, or women's health, any exercise, if you want to teach to your patient, golden statement, first, tell to your patient. Second, teach to your patient. And third, train to your patient. So first, you give an idea about the exercise. Second, you teach the patient how to perform it. If required, you do the correction and provide the training that how they have to do this exercise at the home. That means you train the patient. Okay. So what will happen afterwards without your supervision also, patient can perform the exercise at the home. So I repeat once again, tell the patient, teach the patient, and train the patient. Tell the patient, teach the patient, and train the patient. Now, in which language you have to tell the patient? That question arises to our mind. So try to remember, okay, there was one famous personality in the world by name Nelson Mandela. Yes, I am sure you must have heard the name of it, Nelson Mandela. Very clearly, he has said that whenever you are, discussing or explaining to anybody, okay, you explain in the language which they understands and not in the language which they know. Explain in the language which they understands, not in the language which they know. What does it mean? Your patient must be knowing about Gujarati, Hindi, English, Marathi, and many language. But your patient education, you can give it into the language which they understands. If your patient is from Gujarat, you can prefer to give the instruction in the Gujarati. So remember, tell, teach, and train, and tell in the language which they understand, not in the language which they know. So exercise counseling and training. So give them an accurate idea what exercise they have to do, how they have to do, where they have to do, how long they have to do. Okay. And you train them for that particular exercise. Now, many cardiac patients will be operated. Most commonly performed surgery is CABG, coronary artery bypass grafting. And most of the hospitals, even today, you have seen that they go with the median sternotomy approach, where they make a cut on the mid of the sternum. They open it with the help of the octopus device, and then they perform the cardiac surgery. God has given us a stepney. Like in the car, we have a stepney, an extra wheel. So by chance, if one wheel is going for a puncture, what will happen? You can take out the stepney, that means the extra wheel, and you can keep it and you can replace the punctured vehicle. In the same way, what you can do it over here is when the coronary artery is blocked. So what will happen? You can take the conduits or the graft from the radial artery, saphenous vein, internal mammary artery, and you can perform the surgery. And after that, patient will be referred for the cardiac rehabilitation. So now what you need to do for this group of the patient. Okay, so for the patient who is undergoing cardiac rehab, you need to follow the all phases of the cardiac rehab, phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, and phase 4. But you never you should explain to the patient that once they are operated for CABG, that does not mean that okay, they no need to undergo the same or any other operation in the future. If they are not following the heart healthy living, that means lifestyle modification, if they don't do related to their diet, exercise, and so on, again, these arteries can go for the blockage, and then they may need to be operated for any cardiac surgery. Now we need to do the counseling to reduce the stress. Most of the cardiac patients, they will be under the stress. So what will happen? They'll be always under the stress and anxiety. and they will ask you any questions. It can be questions like when I will be able to drive the vehicle, when I'll be able to go to my workplace, whether I can have the sex or after how many months I can have, if I pass from the airport or any mall, the metal detector will give the beep sound or not. Like this, many questions the patients are going to ask to you. So you need to give a proper answer. That means you need to do a patient education and counseling. So that will be helpful to reduce their stress. Now let us come to the, what are the evidences we have for the cardiac rehabilitation? So exercise-based cardiac rehabilitation, it will reduces the cardiovascular mortality and reduction in the hospital admission and improvement in the quality of life. Improvement in the quality of life by decreasing their symptoms, improving their activity of daily living, and improving their cardiovascular functioning capacity. Now, this evidence is taken from the Cochrane Systematic Review and Meta-Analysis 2016. Now, for the evidence-based practice, we need to have an idea that we have so many databases available for the physiotherapy. So let me give you an idea about some 10 to 12 important or very commonly used standard database in the physiotherapy. PubMed, ScienceDirect, JGate, Ovid, Pedro, DARE, Lilex, Medline, Embase, okay, and Cochrane. So these are some of the commonly used database which you will see in the physiotherapy. Now the next question arises to your mind is, when we have the database available, okay, how to extract the articles from the database? So I would like to give you an idea. Okay, if you have if you go to this database, okay, many of the articles are freely available in the PDF format so that you can download. Some of the articles are available in the form of the abstract. Okay, so now if you want the full text of that abstract, you can approach to your librarian. They can help you to get the full text article, maybe by asking to the other librarian. They have something called as a librarian loan, library loan facility. So with that, they can help you. Or else you can approach to directly the author of that particular research. They may help you out. And third option is you can approach to some of the university. They have a Helinate and they create the user ID and password and they give it to the students who is working into that particular college or the university. But it's not possible for get a paid subscription for all the database. So for some database, some university or college they'll pay, and for some maybe others. So you can help mutually each other to get the full text articles. Okay, now exercise based cardiac rehabilitation is associated with reduction in the mortality and reinfarction post myocardial infarction. So even in the conservatively managed case, the cardiac rehabilitation will be very, very helpful. Okay, and that is what I have said. Even the shorter cardiac rehabilitation program may translate into very big or very good long-term improvement in the outcome of the patient. And that is what the American Heart Journal says in the year 2011. And now let us see the third domain, that is pulmonary rehab. Here we treat the different diseases like the COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, chronic obstructive airway disease or lung disease, all three are same. Restrictive lung disease, interstitial lung disease, then occupational lung disease like bisinosis, biginosis, asbestosis, silicosis, etc. So now this group of the patient, they fit for the pulmonary rehabilitation program. Now in the Surat, a city where I am working, okay, I am working in the two different hospitals. In one hospital I am working since almost 11 years now, where we exclusively see the patient with the COPD, and we have maximum number of COPD patients in the entire South Gujarat. So here we have a very good team which comprises of chest physician, cardiopulmonary physiotherapist, dietitian, then we have asthma or COPD educators, pharmacist, okay, we have a lab, radiology, and so on. So each and every individual, we see the case as one team, and we try to give our intervention so that patient can be benefited. It was very tough in the initial year, okay, for all of us to establish this particular rehab center. But now we have many patients who is coming regularly for the follow-up once in a month. And so many patients, we have seen a very good improvement, okay, when they are regularly coming for the pulmonary rehabilitation program. So along with our technically good technique, which we are giving it to the patient, this group of the patients require treatment for a long time. So it is very important for them to come for the regular treatment. Okay. So, and along with that, we consider not only, we use not only this physiotherapy as an exclusive treatment, even the diet is also played a very good role. And even the do's, don'ts and precautions which we teach to our patient, that is also we give a equal importance on them. That means like wearing the masks, from diet side, like taking the laddus made of the jaggery and sesame. So emphasis are given on the overall improvement of the patient. Now in the pulmonary rehabilitation, again we do exercise, counseling and training. So remember that golden statement: tell, teach and train. And here for the pulmonary rehabilitation, our main focus will be for the strengthening of the muscles and to improve the endurance. Now here again we do the counseling to reduce the stress. And if you are able to give a good pulmonary rehabilitation program, you can reduce the length of the stay of the patient in the hospital. So first thing, you are enhancing the recovery here, and second, you are reducing the financial burden on the patient and their family. And third, the frequency of the hospitalization can also be minimized. So many benefits with this particular approach. And once the symptoms are going down, ADLs are improving, cardiovascular functional capacity is improving, quality of life is improving. Now, we have many professional associations or organizations which regularly published the different guidelines related to the cardiopulmonary physiotherapy. So this pulmonary rehabilitation, it is very useful, that has been given in the form of the statements by the ATS, okay, not the anti-terrorist squad. I am talking about American Thoracic Society. Yes, the same who has given the 6-minute walk test guidelines in the year 2002. The second one is European Respiratory Society. Like this, we have AHA, we have ACCP and many more. Now, what the Cochrane systematic review, it says in the year 2000 that rehabilitation will be helpful to relieve the dyspnea and fatigue. So I'm going to give you an idea about the different positioning, how this positioning will be helpful to reduce the dyspnea on the later part of this particular presentation. And with pulmonary rehabilitations, the patients are going to get moderately large and clinically significant benefits. Now this, how we judge whether the patient has benefited or not, okay? It's not that how you were yesterday and how you are today. If they may say yesterday I was fine, today I'm not fine, so it may be giving you a false interpretation about the progression. So always based on some outcome measure, okay, we tell whether the patient is improving or not. So for example, 6-minute walk distance, whether it has improved or not, whether box scale, you are seeing any changes, positive changes or not. Okay, taking some questionnaire, and then based on that, you are saying whether the patient is improving or not. So based on some evidence, based on some outcome measure, we say whether the patient is improving or not. Okay, and pulmonary rehab is an integrated and important component for the management of COPD. Let us see the fourth and a very important domain in the cardiopulmonary physiotherapy, that is general health promotion and fitness. Now in this any city, you may be from the different cities in the Gujarat or maybe different cities in India, and few of you may be from the other countries as well. My common observation in the city where I stay and work, okay, in Surat, that if you go to any family, at least you will find one person with the non-communicable diseases. We call it as a NCDs. So it may be hypertension or hypotension, it can be diabetes, it can be obesity, it can be thyroid related disorders and so on. So now this NCD group of the patients, we have a good role, okay, for treatment, managing the complication, as well as for the prevention. Yes, it is genetically transmittable, so it is going to come, but we can work on the preventive aspects as well. So at least you can prolong it, or at least you can help the patient to maintain their health and fitness. So NCDs are going to be the main focus of the physiotherapist. So not only managing the complications, we can work on the diagnosis the patient, but even before that, we have a good role to play at the community level for the prevention of the different disease. So major health promotion and the fitness. And it's not that we have to work only on the physical aspects of the health. If you go ahead with the definition of World Health Organization, what it says, the health can be defined as a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, and not merely an absence of disease or infirmity. So what you need to do is you need to assess and you need to treat for the mental health related aspects as well, stress, anxiety, depression, and so on. So that is also the area of focus for the treatment. Most of the times when you meet somebody, okay, they'll say that we have very less techniques available in respiratory physiotherapy, but it's not true. Okay, we have many techniques, just to name few of them. Okay, so manual techniques like your positioning, postural drainage, breathing exercise, autogenic drainage, ACBT, coughing and huffing. With this infographics, you can understand I have highlighted six important basic manual techniques for the cardiopulmonary physiotherapist. Positioning, postural drainage, breathing exercise, autogenic drainage, ACBT, coughing and huffing. Now let us try to understand all these techniques in detail. Positioning. Positioning is a very simple but very, very effective and very, very important technique when we want to implement in our patient. Positioning means you are changing the position from supine to side lying. For some of the patient, we even give from prone position also. For some patient, we give crook lying, hook lying positions and so on. So just changing the position, that will also have a very good effects in the effects for the cardiorespiratory system. So first, positioning will improve the ventilation. That means the amount of air which is going in and out. And second, once the ventilation is improving, the perfusion, that means what, ventilation and perfusion matching, that will also be improved. Now positioning will be helpful to improve the lung volumes. Now here is a golden statement, one mnemonics I am going to give you, and you have to remember this. It is very important for you to remember. Most of the times we forget about the name of the lung volumes and capacities. So when most of you sometimes in your life, you must have traveled with the Indian Railways, and you must have seen there is something called as a two tire AC and three tire AC. Yes, you must have traveled by this TIER, tire. So T stands for tidal volume, I stands for inspiratory reserve volume, E stands for expiratory reserve volume, and R stands for residual volume. It's in a sequence. Remember, tire, T-I-E-R. And lung capacities, it is also four in number. All of you must have applied the interferential current therapy in your patient. And you must be aware, you must have seen many patients with the IV lines in the hospital. So I have made one mnemonics, IFT, in that add the V, I-V-F-T. Inspiratory capacity, vital capacity, functional residual capacity, and total lung capacity. So this is how you can remember the lung volumes and capacities. So this lung volumes will be increased by the positioning, and it will optimize the ventilation and perfusion matching. Now, temporarily, okay, it will be helpful even to reduce the work of the breathing. So for that, you can give the positioning. And of course, the positioning will be helpful to mobilize the secretion, and it will enhance the mucociliary clearance. So let us see the second technique. Postural drainage, okay, PD. Now you must have studied about this technique and you are using it in the patient as well, but today I'm going to tell you what is postural drainage and what is postural drainage therapy. Both are same? No, both are not same. If you go with the standard associations and organizations, they have clearly documented postural drainage is separate and postural drainage therapy is separate. PD, PDT. When you just give a positioning for the mobilization of the secretion, okay, that is called as a postural drainage. But along with the positioning, when you give any manual technique like a percussion, vibration, shaking, or any other technique, we call it as a postural drainage therapy. So remember from today onwards, difference between PD and PDT. Now, postural drainage is a very important technique, okay, where we give the positioning so that the airway, with the help of the gravity, the secretions can be mobilized. But now you have to remember one thing. The area, that means the segments or the lobe which you want to mobilize, it should always come on the top side, so that it should always come on the upside, so that the gravity will assist for the mobilization of the secretions. So in this image, okay, you can see the drainage of the lateral basal segment lower lobe. Now the postural drainage can be given with the help of the postural drainage table, which is like the mechanical one. With that, you can elevate the head end or a foot end. Second, you have the automatic one. That means what? With the remote, you can do the elevation from the head end or from the foot end. And the third variety is with the help of lots of pillow or the pile of the newspaper, you can give the postural drainage positioning. This image, it shows the drainage of the lateral and medial segment in the middle lobe. And what you need to remember, the postural drainage contraindications are very, very important. Very, very important. Because in the night also, you may receive a call, okay, come in the ICU and treat the patient. During your assessment in the ICU, if you found that the patient needs to be given postural drainage, so at that time, you should not search on the neck. You should not call and ask somebody. You should be able to remember. So I feel contraindications are very, very important. So for here, postural drainage contraindications, there are 12 main contraindications. It should be on the tip of the tongue as a cardiopulmonary physiotherapist. So I'm going to give you the mnemonics. Yes, the mnemonics is H raised to 4, 4 times H, P square, 2 times P, toes, T-O-E-S, your toes, and FA, F-A. You must have heard about the deodorant brand FA. So the mnemonics is H raised to 4, 4 times H, P square, 2 times P, toes, T-O-E-S, and FA, F-A. Now, let's see all four H. First H, it stands for head injury. Second, hiatus hernia. Third, severe hypertension, severe hemoptysis. I repeat once again, head injury, hiatus hernia, severe hypertension, severe hemoptysis. P square, pulmonary embolism and peritoneal dialysis. Pulmonary embolism and peritoneal dialysis. Toes, tension pneumothorax. O, esophagectomy. E, eye operation. S, surgical emphysema. I repeat, tension pneumothorax, esophagectomy, eye operation, and surgical emphysema. And FA, F-A, facial edema and aortic aneurysm. Facial edema and aortic aneurysm. So with mnemonics, okay, you can remember it for a longer period of time. You can retrieve it anytime when you want. Okay, so that's the beauty of mnemonics. Now, when we talk about the PDT, postural drainage therapy, okay, so along with the positioning, okay, we need to give some manual therapy techniques, manual approaches or the technique. So mainly we give chest percussion. So percussion, when you are giving, you have to give it with the cupped hand. And before you practice on the patient, okay, first you can practice on yourself. You can practice on a pillow. You can practice on some normal individual who don't have any pathology. Then under the supervision of your professor or senior therapist, you can practice on the, means you can give it on the patient. And then once you are skillful enough, you can practice directly on the patient. So chest percussion means a cupped hand you have to make, and alternatively and rhythmically you have to apply on the patient's chest. Of course, you have to keep one a napkin, towel or a bedspread, and then you have to do the clapping. This can be done in any phase of the respiration. That means you can do it in the inspiration as well as you can do it in the expiratory phase. And this is basically going to help to dislodge and loosen the secretions in the lungs. Now, in the infant or the neonates, okay, the same technique, just suppose a percussion needs to be applied. So you can use the chest percussor, you can use a face mask, okay, and with that you can apply on the patient's chest or with the two finger or with the three finger, okay, a procedure called tenting that can be used and you can apply on the patient's chest. The second technique is chest vibration. Chest vibration can be performed only during the expiratory phase of the respiration. It can be performed manually by the therapist or mechanically with the help of the chest vibrator. So here you are using your hand and you are generating the force from the larger muscle group and you are passing that particular force and then you are providing the vibrations to the patient's chest. Again, this will be helpful to loosen the mucus plugs and the secretions. The third technique is the shaking, where you are holding the patient's chest and then you are shaking the patient's chest into the expiratory phase. Okay, now let us come to the very commonly used techniques in the chest physiotherapy, that is breathing exercises. कि वी हैव सो मेनी डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ ब्रीदिंग एक्सरसाइज. जस्ट टू नेम द फ्यू, पर्सनली ब्रीदिंग एक्सरसाइज, ग्लॉसोफेरिंजियल ब्रीदिंग एक्सरसाइज, डायफ्रामेटिक ब्रीदिंग एक्सरसाइज, सेगमेंटल ब्रीदिंग एक्सरसाइज, लेमेज ब्रीदिंग, ब्यूटूके ब्रीदिंग एंड मैनी मोर. ओके, नाउ ब्रीदिंग एक्सरसाइज विल बेसिकली हेल्पफुल टू इम्प्रूव द वेंटिलेशन. दैट मीन्स अमाउंट ऑफ एयर विच इज गोइंग इन एंड आउट, दैट विल बी इम्प्रूव. Second, it will be helpful to improve the strength and the endurance of the respiratory muscles, and this both will be helpful to, you know, remove the cough from the chest. And second, this breathing exercise, if the patient is performing it, you know, properly, it can be combined. The breathing, not exercise, breathing component can be combined with the many other exercise, and you can give it in the patient also. So that will be helpful to improve the thoracic or the chest wall mobility. So let me demonstrate you one techniques. Okay, that is what we call it as a butterfly technique, where you need to take both the hands like this. You need to bend from the cervical spine, thoracic and lumbar spine, shoulder crossing each other and going down. Okay, while coming up, you need to take the breath in. You are taking both the shoulders like this. Okay, and then you are inhaling, and while you are going down, you need to exhale. So here, what I mean to say that breathing can be incorporated with the many different exercises. Okay, now breathing exercise will be helpful to promote the relaxation and to prevent the atelectasis. Now, what's the evidences says about the breathing exercise? So Cochrane database with the systematic review. Now, if you go with the pyramid of the evidence-based practice, levels of evidence-based practice pyramid, you must have seen in the research, okay, we have different levels of evidence. So if you see that pyramid, on the top of the pyramid, we have meta-analysis, MA, then systematic review, then RCTs, randomized controlled trial. Then you can see single-blinded study, double-blinded study. You can see cohort study, case series, case reports. Then comes opinion, ideas and editorials, in vitro study, laboratory study and so on. So the more you are on the top of the pyramid, okay, the more is the standard, you know, the study design or the evidence which we have. So the Cochrane database of systematic review, what it says that if the breathing exercise can be given for 4 to 15 weeks, so it will improve the cardiovascular functional capacity in the patients with the COPD compared to no intervention. And in the COPD patients, breathing exercises are very, very safe. And COPD patient, our main focus will be on the expiratory exercise, like first the breathing exercise will be our area of focus. You can even teach them positioning to relieve the dyspnea. And later on, you can teach them about the diaphragmatic breathing exercise as well as other exercise. Now, yoga breathing, that means pranayama, pursed breathing and diaphragmatic breathing. These three are proven, and that it will improve the 6-minute walk distance by an average of 35 to 50 meters in the COPD patients. So you can go to all the database which I have told you, and then you can search about the studies related to this. So you will find that, okay, 6-minute walk distance will also improve if the patient is performing the breathing exercise continuously for a longer period of time. Now, one thing you have to remember here, that is to assess the cardiovascular functional capacity, you have many options available. Like you can perform 3-minute walk test, 6-minute walk test, 9-minute walk test, 12-minute walk test, 1-mile run or walk test, 1.5-mile run or walk test. But if you go with the standard evidence, most of the evidence, it says that, okay, 6-minute walk test is very, very standard because it doesn't require much of the technical expertise, not much of the instrument is required, and it reflects the activity of daily living of the patient. Normative values are available, so it can be used very commonly. So even in your clinical practice, okay, whether you are in India or any other place, you must have seen and observed that most of the cardiac or the pulmonary rehab setup, they use 6-minute walk distance as a common, you know, a cardiovascular functional assessment outcome measure. So 6-minute walk distance they take before and after. You can take SBP, systolic blood pressure, diastolic pulse blood pressure, mean blood pressure, oxygen saturation you can take, box scale you can take before and after. So very standardized outcome measure, okay, 6-minute walk test. Now let us come to the another approach, that is autogenic drainage. Okay? So autogenic drainage, AD, it is a European technique. ACBT, autogenic drainage, and force expiratory technique. These three are the European techniques developed by Chevalier. The beauty of these three approaches, it doesn't require any equipment. So once the patient learns how to perform this, they can perform it at the home. Now, the autogenic drainage is having a three different phase, phase one, phase two, and phase three. Phase one is unsticking phase, phase two is collecting phase, and phase three is evacuating phase. Now, here we are using a technique called huffing. In the phase one, for the unsticking phase, we use low volume huff. In the collecting phase, we use mid volume huff. And in the phase three, evacuating phase, we use high volume huff. So with the low volume huff, you can loosen the secretions in the periphery, that means in the lowermost area. With the mid lung volume, you can huffing, you can move the secretions to the larger airway. And with the high volume huff, you can remove the secretions. Okay, so very, very effective technique, and patient can perform at home. No equipment is required, and very strong evidence for the effectiveness. So in this image, you can see phase one, phase two, and phase three. Now, this is really good. Okay, very standard technique, ACBT, active cycle of breathing technique. You can find about this ACBT technique even in orthopedic book, Jain Joshi. Okay, you can read about this technique from that book as well. And of course, most of the cardiopulmonary physiotherapy book, they have mentioned about it. It's not a single exercise. Series of exercise is present in the ACBT. Breathing control exercise followed by 2-3 thoracic expansion exercise. Again, breathing control, 2-3 thoracic expansion exercise. And the last component or the part is your forced expiratory technique, where you have to remove the secretions. Okay, it will be removed. So ACBT. Now here you can see a very good image, okay, which is very, very important. Again, a second technique. The first one was for the artery, radial artery, saphenous vein, and internal mammary artery. I have talked about it. The second is your stepney. That means what? Reserve portion for the respiratory system. We call it as a collateral ventilation pathway. Normally, this pathway is non-functional. But when we perform many of the exercises in the cardiopulmonary physiotherapy, this channel will become active. Now, you need to remember, there are three main components are there inside that. Interalveolar, in between both the alveoli. This is called as a pores of Kohn. In between the two bronchii, that is your channels of Martin. And from bronchi to alveoli, it is called channels of Lambert. So channels of Martin, channels of Lambert, and pores of Kohn. This is what we call it as a collateral ventilation pathway. So this will be activated when the need arises, and most of the time it will be a non-functional area. Okay. And what's the evidence is about the ACBT and AD? Active cycle of breathing technique is to mobilize and clear the secretion. It can be performed even in the absence of therapist, and no equipment is required. And very standard, Journal of Cardiopulmonary Physiotherapy Rehab, they have documented and said that ACBT and AD is both effective for clearing the secretions and improving the lung functions. And this can be used in the COPD patients who is stable according to the patient's and therapist preferences. Okay. Now let us go to the second approach, that is cuffing and huffing. Remember one thing, the cuffing is a forceful and the vigorous maneuver, and the huffing is not a forceful maneuver. Now from the lungs, if you want to remove the secretion, cuffing will be helpful to remove the secretions only up to the seventh generation of the tracheobronchial tree. Beyond that, whatever the secretions are present, you cannot remove with the help of the cuffing. Huffing, you can make use of it for removal of the secretions. Huffing is a less tiring, very comfortable for the patient. So huffing is like, and cuffing is like, you need to take a breath, because you know the phases of cuffing: irritation, taking a deep breath, holding the breath, building up of the intrathoracic and intra-abdominal pressure, and then removing the cuff. Okay, so cuffing and huffing, try to go with the huffing, and if required, okay, then only you go with the cuffing. Okay, so cuffing can also help to move the mucus out of the larger airways, but only up to the seventh generation. Beyond that, it will not be helpful. So this diagram shows about the different phases: irritation, inspiration, compression, and expulsion. Huffing is also known as the huff cuffing. It's like, you are exhaling onto the mirror or window to stimulate. Okay, very simple. It is not forceful as a cuff, and it is better and less tiring. So you can go mostly with the huffing. If required, you go with the cuffing. Now, before I go with the next technique, we are learning since a long time. So in this time of the COVID-19, okay, I want to sing a song for all of you, and I want to do one dance for all of you. Yes, you also can do with me. Okay, so let's start. Okay, I am happy, I am jolly, I am cheerful. I am happy, I am jolly, I am cheerful. Yeah, now let's add some dance steps to it. Okay, I am happy, I am jolly, I am cheerful. I am happy, I am jolly, I am cheerful. Okay, I wish and pray all of you will have a good health. Okay, and can contribute for the teaching and treating, and you can work for the upliftment of the profession. Okay, thank you very much. Now let us see the second component for today's discussion. Again, with this infographics, okay, you can learn about different 6 more techniques: respiratory muscle training, aerobic exercise, dyspnea relieving technique, early mobilization, chest PNF, and breathing retraining. Okay, I repeat once again: respiratory muscle training, aerobic exercise, dyspnea relieving technique, early mobilization, chest PNF, and breathing retraining. Okay, with this image, you can have a look at the respiratory muscle trainer, okay, device. Okay, so respiratory muscle training can be defined as a technique that aims to improve the functions of the respiratory muscle through the specific exercises. Now, these devices are available with the 2 different varieties. In this image, you can see the device which is available is with the different diameters. So what we do is, initially we use the larger diameter so that it will be easy for the patient to perform. As the patient's condition improves, we decrease the diameter of this particular device. So what will happen, the patient has to give a more effort for performing the exercise through this particular device. So as the patient's condition is improving and patient's capability is improving, we use the narrow diameter in this particular device. On this side, we have a device which is having a spring and the resistance inside. So you can adjust the resistance into this particular respiratory muscle trainer device. So initially we keep the less resistance so that patient can perform. As the capacity of the patient improves, we can increase the resistance. So previously it was very difficult to get this particular device, but thanks to the technology, okay, see, I am able to communicate with all of you in the similar way with the help of the technology. Now you can search about these devices on the net. Thanks to Amazon, Flipkart, and many other websites, you can search, you can get the quotation, and if required, you can purchase and practice it. Previously, it was like you need to purchase from somebody, okay, who is in the cosmopolitan or the metropolitan city. It will take a long time and it was very expensive. But now, believe me, these devices are not expensive. You can afford it and you can implement this, okay, in your routine clinical practice. Okay. Now here you can see one image, okay, where you can find that the diaphragmatic breathing exercise is getting done. Okay. So how to perform the diaphragmatic breathing exercise, all of you are aware, but 2-3 instructions which most of the times the therapist forget. The first instruction is, you ask a patient to keep the one hand on the abdomen and another hand on the thorax with the widespread hand. And after that, you ask, this is the component which we forget, you need to ask the patient to wash the hand which they have kept, okay, on the thorax and abdomen. So while they are inhaling, both the hands should move up, and while exhaling, both the hands should go down. Now, for the diaphragmatic breathing exercise, there are 2 schools of thought. Some they say that you need to keep the hand, one on the thorax, one on the abdomen, and some are saying that you need to keep the hand on the abdomen. Both are correct. You can go with both of them because the rest of the procedure is the same. Okay, so here you can see in the positioning which is used for the diaphragmatic breathing exercise, and the therapist is placing the hand on the patient's abdomen. Later on, in the supine position, patient can perform. Now, if you want to improve the strength of the muscle, you use that particular inspiratory muscle trainer device. Or else, what you can do, you can ask the patient to lie down on a supine position, and you can place one small sandbag on the patient, and then you can provide the resistance. Now, as the condition of the patient is improving, the strength of the muscle is improving, you can ask the patient to perform the same exercise in the different functional activities like walking, stair climbing, etc. Okay, so like this, you can implement this exercise in your patient. Aerobic exercise. Aerobic exercise is basically for the conditioning purpose. Okay, so what are the exercise comes over here? Walking, running, jogging, swimming, bicycling, treadmill, arm ergometer, okay, aerobic dance, and so many exercises will come over here. The basic purpose to provide the aerobic exercise is let the patient to use the oxygen and do the exercise for the prolonged period of time. So ATP-PC system, anaerobic glycolytic system, aerobic glycolytic system, you want to use the aerobic system, and you want the patient to perform the exercise for the longer duration. Very, very important for the aerobic exercise is two things. The first one is the warm up and cool down. Without fail, okay, just don't start giving the exercise to the patient. First, they have to undergo the warm-up program, so that what will happen, the chances of injury can be minimized and many more complications can be minimized. And immediately after completing the exercise, let them undergo the cool down period and then let them stop the exercise. Second important point after the warm-up and cool down in the aerobic exercise is the FIT equation, F-I-T-T. Okay, F for frequency, I for intensity, T for type of exercise, and T for the duration of the exercise. Now, very, very important for all of us as a cardiopulmonary physiotherapist to have an idea about how to prescribe the intensity of the exercise. First, frequency. Frequency means how many times in a day they have to do the exercise, or how many times in a week they have to do the exercise. Okay. So if you go with the literature, ACSM, American College of Sports Medicine, and the other literature, Balke has said that for the normal individual, okay, if they do 5 times in a week exercise, that is also fine. Who wants to work in the area of the fitness? For the patient group, maybe you have to give the exercises daily. And frequency means number of time in a day or per week. Second, intensity. Intensity of the exercise means you can prescribe the intensity of the exercise with the help of 1 minute. You can prescribe the intensity of the exercise, prescribe the exercise intensity with the help of 3 important parameters. Please do keep attention on is 3 parameters through which you can prescribe the intensity of the exercise for the cardiorespiratory patient. The first one is through the target heart rate, THR. Second, through the RPE, rate of perceived exertion scale. And third one is through the VO2 max. Now, let us talk about the VO2 max. VO2 max, you can do the analysis with the help of the VO2 max analyzer. So as per my knowledge, most of the institutes, they don't have the VO2 max analyzer. Most of the hospitals, it does not have. So if you want to prescribe the exercise intensity through VO2 max, okay, it is difficult. Indirect measurements can be done with the help of, say, Queen's College step test and many other tests. But better to avoid, because exactly you cannot do it. So now 2 options are remaining to prescribe the exercise intensity. The first one is your target heart rate. That will be very good for your cardiac patient. Okay, there are certain area in our body from where you can take the pulse. Like you can take radial pulse, brachial pulse, axillary pulse. You can take femoral pulse, popliteal pulse, dorsalis pedis pulse, temporalis. You can take for the pulse over carotid pulse. So there are different areas from where you can check the pulse. So what you need to do is you calculate the target heart rate for your patient. So for that, you require maximum heart rate and resting heart rate. And you need to keep it in a formula. So you will get the target heart rate in a range. Now you, while doing the exercise, you teach the patient how to take the self pulse. And even nowadays, many gadgets are available with which, it gives an idea about the pulse. So while doing the exercise, when you are not there with the patient, at least patient will have an idea that this is my target heart rate and my pulse is right now this much. So if their pulse rate is increases, they will have an idea that where they have to stop the exercise. So they will not put an extensive load on the heart. So target heart rate best to prescribe the exercise intensity. Second is very, very standard one, that is RPE, rate of perceived exertion scale, box scale, very commonly used as an outcome measure. Now it is of two different types, traditional box scale and the modified box scale. Traditional box scale, it starts from 6, ends with 20. Modified box scale, it starts with 0, ends with the 10. You can use both of it. It is up to you. It's your preference. Okay. Now what you can do is you can take a print copy of this box scale. You can stick it on a clipboard, and then you can explain to the patient about their levels of breathlessness, that 0 means no breathlessness and 10 means the maximum breathlessness. You can explain, and then while doing the exercise, you can ask the patient to grade their breathlessness based on the box scale. So very, very important golden statement. Okay, remember fit equation, and in that very important is to prescribe the intensity by box scale, rate of perceived exertion scale, THR and VO2 max. Okay, now this is the picture which shows dyspnea relieving positions. Okay, so in the sitting, leaning forward, you can go ahead keeping the pillow and then taking a support and leaning forward. Okay, then you can go for the standing. Okay, you are fixing the upper extremity and leaning forward, taking the wall support and leaning forward, lying down in the supine position, keeping the pillow beneath the knee, lying down in a side lying position, keeping the pillow between the two knees and behind the below the head. Okay, so like this, even you can ask the patient to assume the fetal position. This all are the positioning temporarily. It will provide a comfort or relief from the dyspnea to the patient. Just suppose the dyspnea breathlessness is because of the underlying anemia. So definitely, okay, by giving this position, anemia is not going to run away. You need to cure, or you need to provide the treatment for the underlying cause. Until and unless underlying cause will not go, this dyspnea will not go totally. But these positions are so important that temporarily it will provide the relief to the patient. So immediately after this positioning, you can ask the patient to perform the pursed-lip breathing exercise, which will be helpful to reduce the work of the breathing. Pursed-lip breathing exercise is a traditional standard breathing exercise in which we ask the patient, okay, to take a breath from the nose and to exhale from the mouth. So simple. But we never advise to take a deep breath, normal breath, what they are taking. While exhaling, they have to resemble the mouth like a mouth of a fish. And the another point is they have to exhale for as long as possible and as slow as possible. So the amount of air which they're taking it in, compared to that, more amount of air they have to exhale slowly and for the prolonged period of time. Okay, so you can ask the patient to perform. Okay, it will be something like this. So after positioning, you can try with this. Again, patient will feel a decrease in the dyspnea or the breathlessness. Work of breathing can be relieved temporarily. And the underlying cause has to be treated. And afterwards, okay, you need to work on the diaphragm, because you can go ahead with the diaphragmatic breathing exercise, because diaphragm is the main muscle for the inspiration. It's a dome-shaped muscle originating from the lumbar spine, lower six costal cartilage, and from the back of the xiphoid process, inserting into the central tendon of the diaphragm itself, major muscle for the inspiration. And now what happens? There is something called as the golden statement. You must have studied about this from the first year biomechanics book, Kapanji. You have volume 1, 2, and 3, golden statement. There is something called as the antagonism and synergism of diaphragm and abdominal muscle. This concept, which is mentioned in the book, based on which many techniques we perform in the chest physiotherapy, what it says, for the proper functioning of the diaphragm, you need a proper functioning of the abdomen, and vice versa. For the proper functioning of the diaphragm, you need to work on the abdomen, you need to work on the diaphragm also. So what you need to do, if you want the diaphragm to function, you need to work even on the abdomen and vice versa. Okay, so diaphragm is the key muscle. You need to work a lot on the diaphragm if you want to improve your patients with any problem with the breathlessness and so on. And this is my favorite. Why? Because it is proven clinically highly effective, and it is a very result oriented approach. Okay, assisted coughing techniques. That means you are helping the patient to remove the secretions. You are assisting the patient. Okay, these techniques are divided into two components: manually assisted and self-assisted. Now, the manually assisted techniques are four: costophrenic assist, Himmler's type assist, or anterior abdominal thrust, anterior chest compression assist, and counter rotation assist. Now, I'm going to demonstrate one technique that is called as a Himmler's type assist or the anterior abdominal thrust. In the Himmler's type of assist, what you need to do is you need to stand behind the patient in the standing position and keep the hand on the patient's abdomen like this. And when the patient is going for the beginning with the exhalation phase, what you can do is you can apply the pressure posteriorly backward. Okay, so that what will happen, anything which is obstructing in the patient's upper respiratory tract, it will come out. So that is what we call it as a Himmler's type of assist. Anterior abdominal thrust, it is also same, but we are performing it in the supine lying position. So when the patient is in supine lying position, keep the hand on the patient's abdomen just below the xiphoid process. Make a hand like this, go slightly down and then in, and apply the thrust during the exhalation phase. So anything which is obstructing or choking, it will come out. Okay. Now you might ask a question that what we have to do if there is a choking in the baby. So I have one baby over here. If you have a choking in the baby, it can be infants or the neonates. What you can do is you can take the baby in a prone position in your hand. You need to make use of the gravity. That means you are tilting the baby, and in between the two blades of the scapula, you have to provide a back slap for the five times. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So first with the help of the gravity, and second with the help of the maneuver which you have performed, if anything is obstructing, it will come out. Okay, so this is what you can perform in the neonates and the infants. Now we have some self-assisted techniques as well. Okay, now this you can try with the different patient groups. Okay, it's not only for the cardiopulmonary physiotherapy patient. Just suppose a paraplegic patient, you can try of implementing long sitting self-assisted cuff. Okay, then like this, we have prone on elbow, head flexion self-assisted cuff, long sitting self-assisted cuff, short sitting self-assisted cuff, hands on knee rocking self-assisted cuff, and standing self-assisted cuff. These techniques are really very good and very result oriented when we treat the patients with the cardiopulmonary disease and dysfunction. Okay, now let us come with the importance of early mobilization. This I have given you an idea about the ICU first domain. I have told that we will discuss about this concept into the later on part of my presentation. Early mobilization means what? Okay, I'm not talking about here Maitland's mobilization, Mulligan's mobilization, or McKenzie's mobilization, because mobilization term comes first, it will come this only to your mind. I am talking about, okay, early mobilization means changing the patient's position from supine to side lying, side lying to sitting, sitting to standing, walking around the bed, walking within the ICU, walking within the ward, stair climbing, ascending the stairs, descending the stairs, etc. So this particular things will come as a early mobilization. Even some of the clinical setup, you must have seen that, okay, early mobilization can be done. You can make the patient walk even though they are on the ventilator. But again, it is totally subjective, depends on the patient's condition, and you need to communicate with the intensivist or the head of the in charge of the ICU. And you cannot do it alone. You need to have at least 2-3 people with you, so that one person can take care of the drip, drains, and lying. One person can do the mobilization. One person can shift the equipments and so on. But it's possible some of the ICUs, they are doing that as well. So early mobilization is a non-pharmacological approach. It is gaining lots of popularity right now because all of us are aware about the effects of anesthesia on the respiratory system when the patient is in the ICU because of their condition and because of the equipments, drips, drains, and lab they have, they go for the bed rest. So the muscle will go for the weakness, deconditioning will set in. Okay, so we need to prevent that. We need to enhance the functional independence of the patient. We need to enhance for the early mobilization so that secondary complications, DVT, bed sore, okay, accumulation of secretions, that can be minimized automatically. So they may have limited activity because of diagnosis and equipment. And what happens, they can go for the deconditioning, muscle weakness, and infection. Remember, hospital itself is a source of a infection. We have something called hospital acquired infections. Ventilator itself is a source of infection. We can have VAP, ventilator associated pneumonia. So what we want to do is we want to enhance the recovery fast. Okay, we want the patient to have a quick recovery so that they can be shifted to the other wards and they can be discharged early from the hospital. So not only physically, financially also you want to help, you can help the patient. The financial burden can also be less if they require to stay less in the ICU or in the hospital. Okay, now this ICU based intervention, it plays a very good role in reducing the ongoing physical and neuropsychological impairments in the ICU survival, both in the short term and in the long term. So enhance the quick recovery by the early mobilization. Okay, so you can shorten the hospital stay, but it's a collaborative approach. Multidisciplinary team members are required to make the patient ambulate in the intensive care unit because patients are not getting admitted in the ICU under us. So we need to take permission, we need to discuss, okay, we need to assess how much is the risk, how much is the reward, okay, and then it should be a collaborative effort for the treatment. Okay, okay, now let's come to the important concept. Okay, that is CHAST PNF, okay, proprioceptive neuromuscular facilitation technique. Okay, very old and a gold technique. Okay, and there are so many techniques are available under this which you can implement to many of the patient. Okay, and especially when you want to wean off the patient from the ventilator, you can try giving these techniques. Okay, so what basically the PNF is, externally you are applying the proprioceptives, proprioception. That means the receptors around the joint. Proprioceptives and tactile stimulus you are applying externally that will produce the reflex respiratory movement response that is going to alter the rate and depth of the breathing. So it's more of a practical technique how we are applying on the patient, but very good and a result oriented approach. Let's see what are the techniques comes under this. So the facilitatory stimuli which you are providing, okay, mainly seven different types. Intercostal stretch can be provided, vertebral pressure to the upper thoracic spine can be provided, vertebral pressure to the lower thoracic spine can be provided, anterior stretch lift to the posterior basal area can be provided, moderate manual pressure can be provided, perioral pressure can be provided, and abdominal co-contraction can be provided. So these techniques are really result-oriented techniques and the approach. Only thing you need to practice on the patient, once you are getting the skill, you will get very quick results with this particular techniques. Okay, so I will try to explain you about this. This is how we give the perioral stimulation. This is how we give the high vertebral pressure. The patient is in supine lying position. Assuming this is the spine of the patient. And you need to place your hand, just have a look at the image, you need to place the hand on the upper thorax and you need to provide the high vertebral pressure to the upper thoracic spine. So with this animated image you can understand, okay, that how these techniques can be performed. Okay, let us see the second technique, anterior stretch, lifting the posterior basal area. You need to hold the patient and then you have to give the anterior stretch. Okay, you can see in the image. And this is co-contraction for the abdomen. Okay, so you need to place your hand and diagonally you have to perform these techniques and provide the co-contraction like this. It's actually to show you how to do it practically, but here I'm trying to explain with the help of the animated images. Intercostal stretch. Okay, see, this is how you can provide the intercostal stretch. Okay, so this is about the chest PNF. Okay, now let us see about the breathing retraining. Okay, you are retraining again, you are providing the training for the breathing. So when you need to give the breathing retraining, when there is a dysfunctional breathing pattern, when breathing pattern is altered or dysfunctional breathing pattern is present, you need to give the breathing retraining. So breathing retraining means what? The learning, you need to learn the breath control and you need to pace the different activities that are very vital, you know, for any successful rehab program. So basically you are doing two things, re-educating and correcting the dysfunctional breathing pattern. So four techniques comes over here. Two techniques I have demonstrated. First, the breathing exercise. Second, diaphragmatic breathing exercise. These two I have explained you. Paced breathing with the exercise. That means you are adjusting the breathing with the different activities or the exercise. Exhale with effort. That means what? When the patient is just suppose lifting something. You must have observed, we also hold the breath while lifting something. Just suppose you are lifting something, we are holding the breath. We want to avoid the breath holding. So what we need to do is we need to ask the patient to say count. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4. Then for instruction, should not be given for the inhalation. Inhalation will automatically occur. But while exhalation, ask them to count 1, 2, 3, 4. Then again, inhalation will occur. So we want to maintain the inspiratory to expiratory ratio of 1:2. So these are the four main techniques which we used for the breathing retraining. Firstly, breathing, diaphragmatic breathing, both the exercise, paced breathing with exercise, and exhale with effort. Okay. Now, what are the other important approaches that we used? So with this infographics, you can see the first one I have mentioned here is the yoga. You'll be surprised to know why I have mentioned over here. Yoga is having three main components or the domains, that is yogic asanas, yogic kriyas, and the pranayamas. For many of the cardiorespiratory patient, I have seen that, okay, in the clinical setup, the chest physicians or the cardiologists, nowadays they have even emphasized on performing the pranayama. So maybe a yoga therapist, the person who is expert in yoga, they can teach the pranayama to the patient. So that is the one approach that can be given. Second is hydrotherapy. Hydrotherapy and massage, it is said to be the first physiotherapy techniques practiced by the Hippocrates and Galens. Okay, so in the history of physiotherapy, you can learn about that. Basically, you can give strength related training and endurance related training with the help of the water. So hydrotherapy comes over there. You can implement in the stable patient where there is no fluctuation in the vitals and you can provide some treatment. Okay. Relaxation methods. Okay. Nowadays, forget about the patient. Even normal individuals, they will have three things: stress, anxiety, and depression. Okay. Maybe they are very you know, ambitious, or maybe excessive use of the social media or mobile or internet, or many reasons for that. So relaxation techniques you need to implement in the patient who is having a stress, anxiety, or depression. So that is for the mental health, and which comes under the domain of the definition of health given by the World Health Organization. So what we can do? So for the relaxation methods, okay, if you read the general books, you can go with the color therapy, music therapy, aroma therapy. But if you go with the scientific books written by relaxation techniques, which you must have read in the second year physiotherapy by Rosemary Pine, you have three different types of relaxation techniques which you can implement in your patient. The first one is your physiological techniques. Second is your psychological techniques. And third is your combined techniques. Now, the physiological techniques are Jacobson's progressive relaxation exercise, Laura Mitchell's method, Borkovec's methods, Poppin's method, Alexandra method, and so on. Psychological methods are your goal-directed visualization, visual imagery technique, okay, and goal-directed visualization that you must have heard. Many sports person practice this technique that before they are going for the actual play, they close their eyes and they visualize that, yes, they are going, okay, they are playing, they are hitting the boundaries and sixes and so on. Like this, this technique will be implemented. And the second one, that is visual imagery technique, you all have must experience this in your second year exercise therapy. That person is asked to be in the lying down position. There should be a calm room. Okay, there should not be lighting. Okay, only minimal lighting should be there. And then instructor will ask everybody to close their eyes. Then he gives some commands and asks you to imagine. For example, you are at Goa or in some beach at the seaside. You are on some beach. Now imagine the waves are coming, waves are going, okay, the sun is about to set and so on. And then all of a sudden say that, okay, now you take out your tongue and somebody is squeezing the lemon in your tongue, and reflexively you will feel the taste of that lemon and maybe there will be salivation in your mouth. So that is your visual imagery technique. The combined technique after physiological and psychological one, the combined is your breathing exercise and the yoga. Acupuncture, why it is here, you might be surprised. Okay, personally I don't know acupuncture and I don't use it, but why I had mentioned here, because one of the standard book by Jennifer Pryor and Prasad, okay, they had mentioned acupuncture as one of the treatment for different cardiopulmonary disease and dysfunction. Okay, I have not used, so I don't know, but it is a traditional Chinese medicine. It works on the different meridians. Pranayama, it has been practiced by many of the hospitals. The physicians, they are recommending it. Surya and Chandra Anuloma Viloma Pranayama, Nali Suddhi Pranayama, Sitli Sitkari Sadanta Pranayama, Brahmari Pranayama, Ujjayi Pranayama, etc. And what interesting thing I found about this is yoga breathing. If you search in the different database of the physiotherapy, you will find good studies. Now slowly it has started coming as standardized studies. You will find definitely good evidence for this also. So if you are interested, you can search on this. And what's this steam inhalation? Okay, steam inhalation is a technique or an approach. Now I want to give you some idea. Okay, we give the treatment to any patient in the physiotherapy with the help of electrotherapy, exercise therapy, do's, don'ts and precautions, and some advanced techniques or approaches which is available and if required. Otherwise, most of the times you can manage even without that also. Steam inhalation is a basic advice which any physician will give when the patient is having blockage in the upper respiratory tract, and in that also specific to the nasal blockage. Now, what I want to tell about my experiences, whenever patient is taking the steam inhalation, okay, avoid taking with the help of that electric machine where you need to connect with the plug and water is getting boiled and the steam is coming out. Why? Because most of the time that machine is clean from the outside, and if you go inside the machines where two plates are present, okay, and that is boiling the water, that plates are not getting cleaned. So what happens, the dust which is present on that particular plates, it will be mixed up with the water, and rather than clean means like water which is converted into the vapor, you are taking the vapor with the dust which is present. So then what happens, you may have the allergic reactions. So avoid taking the steam inhalation with that electric machine. If you want to use it, it has to be properly clean. So what's the second option? Second option is to use that traditional method. Okay, that is like boiling the water in some vessel. Okay, and once it is maximum boiled, take it out and then take a steam inhalation. And very important advice is strictly you tell your patient not to use any oil, balm or anything into steam inhalation, because most of them it is having the irritating effects on the respiratory tract. Just normal water they have to use, nothing to be add into the water. I hope I'm clear with this important approaches. Now let us see the very important aspects for my presentation, that is different instruments or the equipments which we used for treatment in the cardiopulmonary physiotherapy. So flutter, high frequency chest wall oscillation, incentive spirometer, IPPB, intermittent positive pressure breathing, mechanical insufflator and exufflators, humidifier, nebulizer, vibrator, manual hyperinflation, ambu bag, ambulatory manual rebreathing unit bag, suctioning apparatus, and inspiratory muscle trainer. Now, I would like to give first an idea about the humidifier. Whenever the low flow oxygen delivery system is provided to any patient, that means it may be through the nasal bypass or through the face mask. So the humidifier will be a wall mounted device, and in the chamber of the humidifier, there should be a presence of the water, normal sterile water, and then the oxygen should be administered to the patient's respiratory tract. Because if you administer the dry oxygen to the patient's respiratory tract, okay, then it may end up with the crust formation. And normally also the oxygen has to be mixed up with the water. That means it has to be the humidified air which has to be introduced into the respiratory tract. So if you found the humidified chamber does not have the water, have the open communication with the other professionals and then discuss, and then water can be added to it. The second one which I want to discuss is about the nebulizer. Almost all the hospitals, all the ICUs, we use nebulizer for giving the aerosol therapy to the patient. The aerosol therapy can also be given with the help of the metered-dose inhaler. You must have seen that metered-dose inhaler with the mother of Salman Khan in the movie Dabang. Puss puss, like that they used to tell. Yes, some of you may not be aware, so I'm explaining. So metered-dose inhaler, they have to shake and you need to teach how to use it effectively. The other way of delivering the aerosol therapy is autohaler, spinhaler, okay, metered-dose inhaler, okay, etc. Rotahaler. So through that you can deliver the aerosols, or through the nebulizer you can deliver. Nebulizer is of two different types, okay, jet and the ultrasonic variety. Now, which are the aerosols you can deliver? You can deliver normal saline. Yes, with the plain saline also you can give the nebulization. But if you give the nebulization with the plain saline for a longer time, you will get the mild bronchodilator effect. If you want to reduce the bronchospasm, okay, say in case of a status asthmaticus, the best way is to give the nebulizer with the salbutamol, okay, which will reduce the bronchospasm. So commercially available Repsul's names are your Salbair, Diolin, Leolin, etc. But basically the content is your salbutamol or salmetrol. If the patient is having a thick secretions, which is, not getting mobilized easily, so before we give the chest physiotherapy, you can give the nebulizer. So in that, you can use something called mucolytics. The most commonly used mucolytics in the clinical setup is N-acetylcysteine. So what it will do is, it will liquefy the secretions which is present. So then later on, it will be easy to remove. So this is how you can, use the nebulizer in the clinical setup. The third one, you can see the vibrator. The vibration which you are providing during the exhalation phase, okay, while giving PDT. Now, if you are treating more number of patients, what you can do is you can purchase the mechanical vibrator, again available on the many online sites, so that you can wear and then you can provide the vibration to the patient's chest. That is the one option. Okay. Now, manual hyperinflation you can provide with the help of the ambu bag. You can do the ambuing. Okay, so basically we use the ambu bag before doing the suctioning. So when you are disconnecting the patient from the ventilator, okay, patient may go for the hypoxia. So what we do is immediately we connect the tracheostomy or the endotracheal tube, and we provide the ambuing. That means we do use the ambu bag. So what happens, we do the hyperoxygenation. So what happens afterwards, you can perform the suctioning or the other procedure. Okay. Now the suctioning is a very important approach or the technique which we use it in when the patient is having the secretions and they are not able to remove with the help of coughing, huffing, assisted cuffing techniques and so on. So suctioning is what basically we use the negative pressure to suck or to remove the secretions. Now remember, keep it in the mind, suctioning cannot clear the lungs. Through the suctioning, you can remove the secretions only from the trachea, and suctioning catheter you have to insert just up to the above the carina, okay, in the trachea. So you cannot go beyond that. So you need to use PD, PDT or some techniques so that secretions will be mobilized and then it will come to the main airway and then later on you can remove it with the help of the suctioning. Remember this, okay? Now suctioning can be done with the three method or with the three different route you can do the suctioning, and the mnemonics for that is SUN. Okay, you might be a very proud son of your father and mother. So SUN is the mnemonics, S-O-N. So you can do the suctioning, suction, S, suction via tube. You can do with the endotracheal tube or with the tracheostomy tube. O stands for oropharyngeal from the mouth, and N stands for nasopharyngeal. So SUN, suction via tube, endotracheal and tracheostomy. O, that means for oropharyngeal, and N for nasopharyngeal. Okay, so these are the different routes through which you can do the suctioning. Now the suctioning machines are available in the hospitals through which you can do the suctioning. If it is not available, battery operated suctioning device or manually you can do, and manual device you can use, and you can do the suctioning. But just suppose electricity itself is not available to any places, and you want to make some device which is like operated without battery or without electricity or without any effort. So some of the therapists, they use a device called Lupin's trap. Lupin's trap is a device. It is having a small container, and one side of the container is having a suctioning tube, and another side of the container you have another tube. The another side, the tube which is present, you need to keep it in your mouth, and the tube on the opposite side you have to insert into the patient's oro or the nasopharyngeal or the through the tube, and with your mouth, okay, you need to generate the negative pressure and then you need to do the suction. Okay, that is called as a Lupin's trap. It can be used, but very dangerous because the infections may come to the your respiratory tract, so need to avoid as far as possible. Okay, so now let us see this all device in the detail. Now you have four main airway clearance devices. PEP, first is your PEP device, that is positive expiratory pressure device. Second is your flutter, third is your acapella, and fourth one is your RC coronet. I repeat once again, PEP device, positive expiratory pressure device, flutter, acapella, and RC coronet. Here you can see the image of the PEP device. Now these all four devices have this common way of operation, means how they operate very commonly, that these devices are having a ball or a spring or something inside the device. So when you are asking the patient to do the exhalation, forceful exhalation, this resistance may be in the form of a ball or a spring. It will allow the air, okay, to flow in the backward direction. So patient is exhaling, but the air will go inside the patient's lung. Now what happens, this air may go behind the secretions, maybe through the collateral ventilation channels, and then later on when the patient is performing it again, okay, the secretions may come out. So that is like in general a common how these particular devices are working. Now what are the evidences we have? So PEP device, the evidence which we have, it says that in chronic bronchitis it preserves the lung function from the rapid decline, and there is improvement in FEV1, which is very important outcome measure to check the efficacy of our treatment. Number of acute exacerbation will be less, and less use of antibiotics and mucolytics are required if patient is able to remove the cuff with the help of this device. This has been documented almost 3 decades back. Okay, less use of antibiotics and mucolytics, because now the secretions are out. So what happens, the chances of infection will be less. The chances of infection will be less, so definitely the antibiotics required will be less. Second is your flutter device. You can see here the image of the flutter device. It is having one stainless steel ball inside, and you can use this device, okay, and this will give a significant improvement in FEV1, FVC and FEF. And very important finding is 6-minute walk distance in cystic fibrosis patient. It can also, it has also shown improvement. Okay, so flutter device can be used. This cystic fibrosis cases are very commonly seen in the Western population. In Indian population, we see very less cases with the cystic fibrosis. And you need to remember about the alpha 1 antitrypsin deficiency and the sweat chloride test when you talk about the cystic fibrosis. So this flutter device is useful. RC Connect, okay, it will reduces the residual volume in the COPD. That means amount of air which is remaining in the lung, that itself can be reduced, and there will be less drop on the FVC, FVV1 in the COPD patient. And a cappella, again, the mode of operation means how you can use it, I have explained. And what the Cochrane says that self-administered airway clearance technique seems to be offering more choice, independence and convenience in performing this in the daily routine. So no therapist is required. Second, now the biggest barrier was these devices were very expensive previously. Now it is available at the reasonable cost. We were not getting this equipment previously. Now the availability is very easy. Okay, you can go with the online, Amazon, Flipkart and many more online sites. So cost is reasonable, availability is good, research is also supporting. Okay, so now slowly you can make use of these devices. Incentive spirometer, very, very simple, very commonly you will see with almost all CABG and cardiac surgery patient with them, or the pulmonary surgery patient with them. I also have one incentive spirometer device with me and I'm going to show you. Okay, so it is having maybe a one ball device or a three ball device. Okay, and basically when we are using this device, you need to remember the two things, that is SMI. Yes, you must be aware about this, sustained maximal inspiration. And second, collateral ventilation channel. I have explained about the collateral ventilation channel, interalveolar force of Kohn, okay, then interbronchial and bronchoalveolar. So SMI means what? Okay, if your patient is able to perform this, first instruction, it has to be okay kept in such a way that there should not be any air leak from the corner of the mouth. Second, it has to be kept on the level like this. Third, taking one ball, two ball or three ball up, it is important, but not that much. Our importance is after taking the one ball, how much second they are able to hold up. Now this is the period where the breath is getting hold, okay, and maybe your collateral ventilation channel will be activated. So taking one, two or three up, it's fine, but after taking it up, you should be able to hold it. That is very, very important. Okay, sustained maximal inspiration. Okay, and for pediatric age group, you must have seen in this image, okay, with the different cartoons it is available. So that is to provide a visual biofeedback to them. Okay, if you tell them you do it, okay, so that up to 600 ml per second it should go, it will be boring for the pediatric age group. So it's available with the different cartoons, so you can purchase and implement it for your pediatric age group patient. Okay, so this is what about incentive spirometer. But just doing the exercise with the ball, and if you just tell you do it for 10 times per day at every 1 hour whenever you are awake, it will not work out. You need to explain that what is the importance of the hold and how it will make a changes in your respiratory system inside your lung. Then only the patient will do this simple but highly effective equipment, okay, for the treatment purpose in a proper way. Now this is very, very important and effective, high frequency chest wall oscillation. In that we provide a vest, okay, or a jacket, and we switched on the machine. So what happens, it will be started at the low pressure and frequency initially, and then later on the frequency and the pressure with which it provides the compression, it will be increases. So according to the patient's ability to tolerate, okay, and the recommendation from the physician, this can be given it to the patient. Now each squeeze of this jacket vest, it will increases the airflow inside the lung, and it will loosen the secretion, that means the mucus, and it will increase the patient's ability to remove the cuff. Okay, so high frequency chest wall oscillation. This is very, very useful clinically. Mechanical insufflators and exufflators. You can see in the image how the machine looks. Now, what this machine basically do is it will use the positive pressure to deliver first to the upper airway, and then to the maximal lung inhalation. Positive pressure is going inside, you are providing the positive pressure, and then there will be abrupt shift in the pressure, that the negative pressure will come and it will suck the air. Now there will be a rapid change in the positive and negative pressure. So what it will do, these changes will be stimulating the airflow changes that will occur while doing the cough. So what will happen, it will assist you for the sputum clearance. Very, very effective research is supporting this. Now comes to last two and a very simple yet effective method which we need to implement for the cardiopulmonary patient, that is about the importance of patient education. Now Nelson Mandela said patient education should be, means based on that I am saying the patient education should be in the language which they understand, not in the language which they know. So patient education is very, very important. So for effective health education, okay, we need to go ahead with the tailor-made approach. It is very, very simple. Just suppose a child doesn't like to have a rice, then you made some items from the rice, okay, like maybe idli, dosa or whatever, and then you try to provide to the child. In a similar way, when your patient is not able to understand how you are explaining, okay, don't get irritated, don't get frustrated, change the method how to explain to the patient. Okay, tell, teach, train. Tell, teach, train. Another thing, you can write it down in the language, you can draw some diagram, and then you can explain to the patient. Okay, you can take a video of you, and then you can give it to the patient that this is how you have to perform. So there are n number of ways, okay, with which you can tell, teach, and train the patient. Now always very important and golden statement is always we need to understand need, interest, concern, and expectation of the patient. I repeat once again, need, interest, concern, and expectation. And based on that, we need to always address the patient's need, interest, concern, and expectation first. Okay. Of course, which is more important, okay, that we have to deal. But along with that, the second priority also from the patient's expectations. Now, another thing is we need to always provide the physiotherapy treatment session should be as short as possible. Okay, don't stretch your physiotherapy session for a very long period of time. Okay, but it should be effective, not short, not too long, adequate, but it should be effective. That is our prime goal. Okay? Now, in the conclusion of this particular session, I would like to say that there is availability of the low-cost airway clearance devices which can be used even in the Indian clinical setup. So forget about the cost and availability. It is now within the reach. As an Indian, we can use this. Okay. So go for the Flutter, Acapella, RC Cornet, go for the suctioning device. You can purchase many mannequins for the CPR and so on. You can search about this. You can get the quotation. You can purchase it. You can implement in your patient. Okay. And second thing, there are so many tools and approaches are available. Okay, it's not that we have a few techniques, lots of techniques are available, but the selection of which tool, it needs lots of knowledge. Okay, and it requires lots of clinical reasoning skills, that what to use where and when. Okay, when you can fight with the needles, you need, no, don't need a sword. In the similar way, when a simple technique works, you don't need any hi-fi techniques, instruments or equipments for the treatment purpose. Remember, when the work can be done with this needle, you don't need a sword. In the similar way, when the technique can treatment can be given with the simple approach, you don't need any hi-fi techniques and so on. Okay, old is gold. That is what this, the third aspect says. The advanced airway clearance technique has many advantages over the conventional approach, but it cannot replace the conventional approach. Old is gold. It is also research proven. But what we are going to do, as we are from the newer generation, okay, we are coming in the area where the technology at its peak. So we are going to follow the traditional approach. Along with that, one or two new approach also we are going to implement, which is clinically good, research proven. So change is the only thing which is permanent in our life. So use the old gold concept. Along with that, you can implement some or the other new approaches also for your clinical practice. Most of us are reaping the fruits of the tree which has been planted by our seniors. So I would like to extend my sincere thanks and gratitude to all my professors at KLE's Institute of Physiotherapy, Belgaum, NIT Institute of Physiotherapy, Mangalore, and Sri Swaminarayan Physiotherapy College management, staffs and students who had a significant impact on the professional aspects of my life, and all the principals and professional seniors in the Gujarat for their continuous guidance to me. Okay, so thank you very much. But before I end, I must say, as long as I strongly believe, as long as there is an existence of human being on the earth, there will be need for physiotherapy and physiotherapist. Again, a golden statement, as long as there is an existence of human being on the earth, there will be need for physiotherapy and physiotherapist. So wish you all the best. I hope this particular session has added some few drops of information in your present knowledge. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tarpan sir. It was a very wonderful session. It was a very, I expect that, I hope that all the students have a good, gained a particular knowledge. I also like to convey that we are also adding this session on our YouTube channel. So all the, those participants who have not joined the link, they will be at this webcast, the webinar will be available on our YouTube channel. Thank you, Tarpan sir. Thank you. Thank you very much for all the participants. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Tarpan sir, stop presentation karo.